working at a Velneo company. It's part of the Visual MC group. It's a company placed in Gijón and Porriño in the northern Spain. And along the years, along the past years, I've worked in different companies as C++ developer. And every one of these companies has his particular building system, and you have to adapt to it when you change your company. And in particular, in one of them, at the early days, in one of them, I found that the linker spends a lot of time to doing this job, about 15 minutes. And it was due to the inline flags. And I was surprising. 20 minutes is a long time. And without these flags, the linker only needs few seconds, but the application ran 10 times slower. So I thought, what do you know about inline? Inline is a suggestion to the compiler to take the function code and put it at the point of this call. But a suggestion? I can achieve a great performance, but it depends on suggestion, as desires compilers, and the sense of humor of the product. I was very intrigued. So today I'm here to share my experience, but don't expect something like a cookbook in line. It will be different. And I started looking at the different meanings of inline. And the first is regarding to the one definition rule. Usually, our code is placed in different files. For every CPP file, we build a translation unit. But my point is, these translation units serve files. If we try to define, in this example, for example, base 4 or version in the base 8 file, when we build the translation units, we have no any problem. But when we try to link them, yes, this is a problem, because the linker can take one of them, because there are ambiguity. What foo base function, or what version must be chosen? So the standard defines the one definition rule. As I say, that every translation unit can have at most one definition for any variable, function, and so on. But it says so that every program, know the difference between translation unit and program, shall contain one definition of every non-inline function or variable. And the inline function will be defined in every translation unit. But the point is, if P implies Q, not Q implies no P, it means every function or variable can be defined in more than once in a program. So if we qualify in this function and this variable since C++ 17, within line, we have no problem. Magically, the function has disappeared because it's put in line, but the version is the same. And the linker has no problem because the one definition rule guarantees that the linker can choose one of them. Second meaning, inline namespace. What is inline namespace? Sometimes to C code, or so code, is the clearest way. So inline namespace A bracket, blah, 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 bracket, is equivalent to namespace A bracket, whatever, bracket, using namespace. And how it works? Let's see this example. If we try to call foo, qualifying with A and B, we have an ambiguity, because foo is the same function defined in C1 and C2. So we cannot do it. Sorry. But within inline namespace, C2, we can do it, because it's taken by default. So there's no problem. And more, we can do the same in other levels of these nasty namespaces. We can do this without any problem. OK, this is to understand. Before this, inline namespace was introduced in C++ 11 regarding to the standard discussions about, in that time, new standard library. You can read the paper 2535, because I think it's a good point to enter in the standardization world. But going back to the performance, to the my first words on this talk about 10 times faster and these kind of things. And the simplest, with inline, we can avoid function calls. For every call, we can do a lot of things, like annotating the next instruction at the back of the function, preparing the return statement, putting the parameters on the stack, and so on. So, okay, if we have not to do it, we gain time, better performance. But this is not the key, because it's not a fault. Yeah, I finished the talk. No. This is the, for me, in my experience, this is the point. The optimization of our function using inline. Let's check out this example, okay? We have a foo that takes a vector, sets vector ii component to 0, stores jj component in two local variables, and return the sum of them. If we test with this extremely simple vector, this is the return. We are going to optimize this function. For example, we can do this thing. Yeah, set the ii component to 0, and we don't need the local variables. Let's see a few seconds to check it. And if we have to taste it, and no problem. But obviously, this example was chosen, so there is a problem. What happens is the index is the same. The two indexes are the same. This is the result. Take your time, because it's the point. But when we try to use the other function, the result is different. Okay? It's my example. I think you need time, because it's not complex, but you think about this. And, okay, I cannot do it. These optimizations cannot be done. But depends on the context. Check out this other example. With the same function, we have a loop and a call to this function, okay? And we put this function in line. So we are doing the substitution. Okay, it's the same, substitution alone. But at this point, we know that the index ii and jj are different, and we can do the optimization. In this part of the program, in this particular point of our program, if there are not all calls to foo function, we cannot do it. Maybe, depends. But at this point, we know that the index are different. So inline gives the optimizer superpowers. It's like a X-ray vision to look through the function. And we can do more optimizations. This is the same. This is the same writing, so different, but there's no optimization here. Okay, it's data is the access to ii component. But my point is, if vector is now as contact on spread, at this point, the optimizer can do this. Then we can do these kind of things. We can use prefetch techniques, or take the data in the cache memory. Only can do it if the function is inline. So this is the key. It's not only for a lot of calls. Yeah, it's right. But this is the point. The optimizer can do a lot of things if we put in line. At the same time, this can happen. I mean, I try to explain, not with this simple example, but if we abuse, if we do a lot of inline function everywhere, if we put everywhere inline functions, we can decrease the cache hit ratio, especially if the functions are big. Another question, if we substitute every function call, we have bigger and bigger objects. So maybe we have a memory problem, right? And the other, this is, if we try to debugging and we are putting the function in line, like any other optimization, check out this example. It's divided by zero, okay? The first thing I learned about programming, don't divide by zero. Yeah, okay, I divide by zero, but the GDB or my debugger says the problem is here, and all of us know that this is not here the problem. The problem is in the division, okay? But it's not the same code, it's not really what the compiler has, because it's optimized. My suggestions to inline. Okay, first of all, not put everything. Your profiler, detect your bottlenecks, and yeah, inline small functions call a lot of times. Yeah, I feel like Cookie Monster and near and far, and because this advice is extremely easy, but you have to use two profilers. For getters, setters, and these kind of things, putting them in line can save time, but it's not a rule. There's no rule. Because as I tried to show you in the previous examples, it depends on your hardware to prefetch or to post your cache and these kind of things. So to do the optimization, it depends on the point of your call. It depends. Always, benchmark your applications. Play with the flags, okay? Like in my company, we can spend a lot of time tweaking your flags and putting line or not in line because it works, okay? And of course, do clean code always and load the message as yours. The performance is the second part of all of this. And okay, at this point, I suppose that you have the red and the blue pill. And it's only for fun, eh? Okay? I know this is a C++ party, so I expect that all of you take your pill and sedate and jump or scream or whatever. Well, it's the university, sorry. We can be serious, but we try it. And I check the most of response, and I select the whatever you want, okay? Can we define inline foo in a CPP file? What do you think? It's not a test. It's not for your knowledge. It's for fun. What do you think? And please, share your your opinion. Hey, don't be silly, all of you. Okay, most of it, you're okay? Okay. But be aware of linking errors, okay? Because if we are doing the substitution in a CPP file, probably the function disappears. And if you try to link an ice den, there's no function. Okay? Next one. What do you think about this? Please? Whatever. Okay. It's not a trick, it's for real. No. The template function is not inline by default. If you want to put it, you write inline. Okay? Next one. About context preemption, function or variables. What do you think? Okay, so you, most of red, yeah, it's correct. But the reverse is false, okay? An inline function is not, or variable is not in context, but default. Next one. Can a function be inline and virtual? You know more inline about than me. Okay, fantastic. No. Yes, it can be, and it's useful. And we are doing a lot of times. For example, okay, if we select blue, a default constructor or default destructor are inline, and we are using in here when we are deriving from these classes, and this inline, no problem, nicely. Can inline function contain a static variable? What do you think? Most are red. Okay, it's red. It's red answer. But similar, you know that static has a lot of meanings, and it depends on, we have to try to have encounter problems when I try to link. And the last two, my favorites. If a function is inline, does the compiler generated object code for this function? Anyway, the compiler has done the substitution. Yeah, okay, you know, it's blue and it's correct. For example, if you are using a pointer to the function and pass them to a parameter, the compiler generates the code for this function. And the last one. Do you remember what is a final recursive function or a simple function? Simple call only of itself, and final is the last operation. There is no more operation after the return of the calls. I don't think. 50-50. Interested red, but no. Oh, no, sorry, it's a mistake. Yes, he can do it. Oh, the last one, I followed the loss. Oh, this is me. This is me. Oh, thank you. I have probably a joke, but this time at the end, sorry. I have prepared this for the questions, and I feel nervous, and I forgive it. Okay, I suppose you know a lot of new things about inline. My special thanks to my reviewers, my English teacher, my family to help with the bills, and with my friends to put in all the seats, and of course all of you for sharing this time with us. See you around.
Has anybody an inline question?
Thank you for the talk. I saw a discussion, I don't remember, I think it's Stack Overflow or something like that, that said that you should let the compiler decide if a function must be inline or not.
Yeah.
So
this is the point of the jokes about your suggestion. You can apply to the compiler with flags, put this in line, tal, but at the very end, the compiler choose to do this direction.
I'm aware there's a flag, not a flag, I think it's a built-in function called force inline in the, I know.
Depends on, for example, in GCC or Silana, I don't remember because I was starting with different, you have to write in your code, in your source code, attribute, always inline, but it works in Silana and not in GCC or the reverse. But, for example, Intel compiler use IPO flags and inline depth, and so then if you check the GCC information, GCC documentation, you have a lot of, especially about the depth of the inline calls, of the code of the function. But I try to show that it depends in the particular case. This is not a rule of thumb, it's absolute truth about this. So the suggestion remains at the end.
Okay, thank you.
Last question. Okay.
It's clear.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.